So, next few minutes we'll discuss on positive and negative photoresist, their composition and their working principle. First, let us discuss on negative acting photoresist. And this negative acting photoresist is based on polyisoprene in the form of cyclized rubber. In the photoresist film, there are three basic components. One component is known as a resin, second component is known as sensitizer, and third component is solvent. As I told you, that photoresist is a liquid material, high viscous liquid material. So, some solvent is required to maintain the viscosity of that particular resist. And some photosensitive material should be there, which will help reacting of the resin material. That is photosensitive material. And some resin is there, which is the basic material and which changes its form after absorption of UV light. And in case of negative photoresist, the resin material is polyisoprene, and that is basically cyclized rubber. It involves two organic reactions, negative photoresist. The first reaction is free radical polymerization of alkenes, which is hydrocarbon, and the second reaction is photodissociation of azides. And these azides material are highly unstable. It liberates nitrogen in the presence of light. And this photodissociation of azides, these azides is sensitizer material. The sensitizer materials used in negative photoresist is bisaerial diazides. These are all organic composition. And this bisaerial diazides as a sensitizer is added with polyisoprene, which is a resin material, for rapid and complete polymerization upon exposure. The whole thing, that means polyisoprene together with bisaryl diazides, is a polymer material. Upon exposure of ultraviolet light, reaction will take place and the complete polymerization will be done. And due to the polymerization, a cross-linking reaction will take place. That means as soon as the UV light is absorbed by the photoresist, the chain reaction, that means this resin material, which is polyisoprene, with the help of diazides, they will form certain chains in cyclic form. And because of that chain formation, it will not be dissolved in the developer solution. That means it has been completely polymerized. Exposure of light results in cross-linking of resin molecules by several sensitizer molecules. The chain reaction further polymerizes the resin. Just now I discussed that point. Next, in addition to resin and sensitizer, photoresist formulation requires a solvent to keep resist fluid for ease of application, because you have to put or you have to get uniform thickness photoresist film. So for that, you have to use some solvent to have proper viscosity, so then you can put uniform layer of this film on the silicon dioxide substrate. For negative photoresist, the solvents are mixture of aliphatic and aryl hydrocarbons. So that means the three materials, one is resin, that is polyisoprene, then sensitizer, that is mixed aryl diazides, and the third one is the solvent. Solvent is here mixture of aliphatic and aryl hydrocarbons. So these are the three materials in proper proportion is mixed, and the photoresist, negative photoresist, is formed. Depending on the compositions of the constituents of the photoresist material, the requirement of energy, that means which is obtained from the ultraviolet light, is different. So different brand of photoresist are available with different companies. They will name it with certain brand name, certain number, and each photoresist will give you different thickness for the same spin speed. That means that the viscosity are different, and at the same time the exposure time for completion of this reaction, polymerization reaction, may be different for different photoresists, and that is also mentioned by the manufacturer of these particular photoresist. Typical exposure energy required for 1 micron thick negative photoresist is 10 to 20 millijoule per centimeter square. Some typical values is mentioned here. And normally we use 1 micron photoresist thickness for normal applications of VLSI processes. Okay. Next comes development. So in the exposure, we have seen how the polymerization takes place, and chain reaction and cross-linking. Because of the cross-linking, some chain reactions will be there and some polymer will be formed. And in the developer solution, if you put the whole wafer after the reaction has taken place on exposure of UV light, the cross-linking under exposure produces a highly insoluble film. Pattern is formed by washing away the polymerized resist with a solvent. An obvious choice is hydrocarbon mixture similar to the resist solvent, because the solvent used for controlling the viscosity, the same solvent may be used for removal or washing away the unpolymerized resist, because unpolymerized means their reaction has not taken place. That means there the ultraviolet light has not been exposed those regions. So that means those particular region can be removed or washed away using the same solvent of the photoresist, which is used for maintaining the viscosity of the film. Mild straight chain hydrocarbon produces a final line width. If the reaction, the chain reaction which is taking place when UV is exposed, if this is mild and if the chain formation is straight one, not in irregular fashion, then we may expect final line width. The fine line definition after exposure and development is dependent on the molecule size after polymerization. If after polymerization the molecule size is very large, then you cannot expect very fine line pattern after lithography and development. Okay. The cross-linked resin will absorb the solvent and result in swelling and distorting the image. The solvent development must be followed by a rinse with a fluid that removes solvent from the resin. Let me explain this particular point. Now, what we found in case of negative photoresist, so you see here, so this is negative PR, this is negative PR, and this is say SiO2. Now, when you put the, when you keep the whole substrate in the developer solution, so here was the mask, so that means from this particular region, the photoresist will be removed, no reaction will take place in negative photoresist. Okay, no reaction will take place, but here the polymerized layer, in the polymerized layer, the cross-linked resin will be formed here. So they will absorb some of the developer solution, because in the sidewall, so there some of the developer solution will be absorbed by this layer, and as a result of which what will happen, you can see here, so this particular absorption will lead to some of the soiling action. So soiling action, because this side and this side, it will soil, because here lot of developer solution this particular surface will face, because after it is dissolved, because no reaction is taken, although he has cross-linked reaction has taken place, even then there is a chance of absorption of this developer solution, as a result of which some soiling action will be there, and because of that soiling action the pattern will be deformed. If I want a line like this, straight line, so because of the deformation, so you can get, end up with a line like this, because of the soiling action, the sharp edge you may not get it. That is one of the major problem in negative photoresist. Now you can reduce this effect by using a solvent which will immediately dissolve the developer solution. That is known as rinser material, rinser solvent. What is the purpose of the rinser solvent? That after development is over, if you immediately put the entire substrate in a rinser solvent, then that rinser will dissolve whatever the developer is left on the polymerized area. So the soiling action will be small. That means after developing, you are thoroughly washing the substrate by using a rinser solution. And that fluid removes the solvent from the resin. What is that developer solution? Now, the property of the rinser should be such that it should have an affinity for the developer while not absorbing into the polymerized resin. That means this rinser solution should be such that it will dissolve the developer solution. Whatever the developer remains there, it will take it out. But at the same time, this should not attack the polymerized resin. The rinser solution we are using to remove the developer only, but it should not react with the polymerized resin. One choice of this rinser solution in case of negative photoresist is N-butyl acetate. Typical spray develop and rinse time for 1 micron negative photoresist layer is 5 to 15 seconds. That means after exposure, you develop the wafer, and just after developing the wafer, you rinse it with a rinser solution, which is N-butyl acetate. And you can rinse by using the spray. You can spray the solution on the surface so that developer solution, whatever leftover is removed, but it will not attack the polymerized portion. Next, I am coming to positive acting photoresist. So let us see what are the compositions in a positive acting photoresist. The basic composition in a positive photoresist material is same as negative. That means one should be the resin, one should be the photosensitive material, which is sensitizer, and third is the solvent. These three materials should be there. Okay. Positive photoresist does not rely on polymerization. Here, the polymerization reaction is not there. There is no formation of cross-linking chain, etc. Sensitizer offers photosensitivity. That is the basic job of the photosensitive material. And here, diazoxides are used for sensitive material, photosensitive material. On exposure to UV light, short-lived ethane is formed, which in the presence of moisture forms a carboxylic acid. Being an acid, this compound reacts with alkaline material and forms a soluble ester. And I have also mentioned earlier that on exposure to UV light, the photoresist, positive photoresist film become soluble in developer solution. On exposure, it becomes soluble. It is not becoming hardened in exposure. It will not like that in negative photoresist. So what happens? After exposure, a ketone is formed and whose lifespan is very small. And in the presence of moisture, it forms a carboxylic acid. And since it is an acid, if we use an alkali material, it will form an ester, which is easily soluble in the aqueous solution. So that is the basic principle in positive photoresist. No cross-linking reaction, no polymerization. Exposed resist is washed away in an alkaline solution such as dilute sodium hydroxide. Because, as I told, the carboxylic acid is formed, which is highly unstable, and that acid may be washed away or dissolved in an alkaline solution, which is dilute sodium hydroxide. And in fact, in your positive photoresist, which you have used in your laboratory, you can note that that is nothing but a dilute sodium hydroxide solution. Now, the resin in a positive photoresist film has no photochemical sensitivity. Rather, it provides chemical resistance, viscosity, stability of the film. In case of positive photoresist, the main job of the resin is to provide chemical resistance, provide adequate viscosity and stability of the photoresist film. A resin must be soluble in alkalis to allow exposed resist to dissolve, but must be insoluble enough to prevent excessive dissolution of unexposed resist. That should be the property of the resin. In addition to resin and sensitizer, a solvent is used such as ethylene glycol monoethyl ester. That is basically solvent to adjust the viscosity of the photoresist film. And that solvent here is ethylene glycol monoethyl ether. Ethylene glycol monoethyl ether is a solvent material of the sensitizer and resin, which is used in positive photoresist. Optical sensitivity is within 300 to 450 nanometer of light. That is in the ultraviolet region, 300 to 450 nanometer of light. As I mentioned you earlier also, adhesion is a major concern in positive resist formulation. Positive photoresist process requires careful substrate treatment and the use of an adhesion promoter, that is HMDS, hexamethyl disilicene. That is used as an adhesion promoter, and we have to be careful enough so that substrate surface is highly clean. It has been observed sometimes from that the if you go for lithography directly after the oxide is formed in a diffusion furnace or oxidation furnace, then the adhesion is not that much severe. But after forming the silicon dioxide in a furnace, then if you keep the substrate for a long time, means maybe after 1, 2, 3 days, then if you go for lithography, then it creates some problem, because from the environment, the oxide adsorbs some of the impurities, some of the gases, and some moisture material. So, because of that, the adhesion is extremely poor in that case, because surface property has been deteriorated if you keep it for a long time in your the processing lab. But if you directly taking this silicon substrate from the furnace, means oxidation furnace, if you directly go for photolithography, the problem is not so severe. The adhesion is very good. Even without HMDS, we can go for lithography, and the film will not come out in the oxide etching solution. Peel off is not there. Next, development of positive photoresist. In the development, positive photoresist development is a very crucial process. Both the soluble and insoluble portion of a positive photoresist are removed at observable rates by the developer. Again, I am repeating this point. That is, after exposure, some portion of the photoresist film is soluble, exposed portion, and unexposed portion will not be soluble in case of positive photoresist, that we told you. That means in the developer solution, only the soluble portion, that means which is not covered from the exposed, from the exposure of light, that has to be removed, isn't it? But we have seen, along with that portion, that means exposed portion, which has become softened after exposure, the covered portion where no reaction has taken place, from that portion also some material is dissolved, some PR is dissolved, which is not likely the case in negative photoresist. But the dissolving rate in the exposed portion is extremely high compared to unexposed portion, because unexposed portion, the ester has not formed in the reaction, and ester is soluble in the developing solution. In spite of that, some of the photoresist material will be dissolved in the developing solution. So, the developing process is highly crucial. In what way? That is developing time. If you develop it for a longer time, then along with the exposed portion, unexposed portion also may completely developed, completely washed away. Just now you mentioned few minutes back that if film thickness is non-uniform, what will happen? Here also you may have the same problem. because in case of positive photoresist, since the unexposed portion also washes little bit, so if we allow longer time in the developer solution, then both exposed and unexposed portion will be washed away, you will not get any pattern. That means that developing time is to be cautiously followed in case of positive resist development. If it is overdeveloped, longer time developed, then you may lose the whole pattern. Developing speed is a smoother function of absorbed light and also depends on developer concentration. Obviously, if the developer concentration is very high, so it will develop instantly. And also, if you expose for longer time, then also it will wash away, it will develop immediately. Within a small amount of time, it will be developed. So that means the developing time is dependent on two things. One is the how long you have exposed, and the second point, what is your concentration of the developing solution. So we have to see that the developing should not be very fast. The fast development will not give you an exact replica of the mask on the wafer, on the resist pattern. There may be some distortion of the line width. There may be deviation of the pattern definition or line width. So better we have to follow the slow development. At the same time, you have to also think longer development time may deteriorate the pattern definition also. So some optimization is to be done. And what should be the exposure time, what should be the concentration of the developer solution, what should be the time, that is decided with our repeated experiments and experience gained from previous experiment. Okay, that is known as standardization. Development begins at the surface and then proceeds downward in both exposed and unexposed area, and laterally also widening the walls. Because when the solvable portion is washed away, then the developer solution will attack the side walls. If it attacks side walls, in that case, the pattern may be widened also, because after window is open, the developer solution, the exposed portion or unexposed portion is washed away, then it will start from the side wall, the remaining portion, and it will increase the width of the that window or that pattern. So that has to be taken care. Exposure and development times can be manipulated to point wider or narrower geometries from a mask plate. That is again one important point. That means if a line definition, line dimension on a mask plate is say 2 micron width, that 2 micron width can be made on the wafer level maybe 1.8, maybe 2.2, like that. Some variation you can make wider, you can make narrower. How? By adjustment of the exposure and development time. Because as I told you, that after removal of the solvable region, then it attacks the sidewall. So if you allow a little bit more time, it attacks sidewall, so width will be different. So line dimension may change. Wider you can get. And again, by adjusting the exposure and development time, narrower geometries also can be achieved, because whatever you achieved in positive resist, that will be narrower in negative, because this is a complementary. In one case it will widen, in one case it will be narrower. So that means just by adjusting the exposure and development time, the line dimension can be changed a little bit according to your desire. Then I will discuss on performance comparison on positive and negative photoresist. There are some advantages and disadvantages of both the photoresist. One, first let us consider negative photoresist. Negative photoresist has limited ability to resolve fine line because of number one, size of molecules, and number two, chain reaction. During my discussion on the negative photoresist, I mentioned that the fine line definition is dependent on the molecule size of the chain reaction. The same thing is mentioned here. The size of the molecules after reaction has taken place will decide the pattern, how fine line pattern you can get using the negative photoresist process. Next, swelling of polymerized resist during development. This is another harmful effect, disadvantage of negative photoresist, the swelling action. If it swells in the developer solution, then the patterns will be deformed. Deformation will take place, and then you will not get high resolution because of the swelling action. And sometimes it happens, two lines which are very small, gap between the two lines is very small. If it is so, then because of the swelling action, the two lines may join together, because a narrow gap is maintained, left side and right side both will swell and they may join together. In that case, you cannot get the narrow line. Here is the limitation. Here poses the limitation in negative photoresist. Using the negative photoresist, you cannot get very fine line. So resolution in negative photoresist is limited to 2 to 3 micron only. Below that, means below 2 micron, normally negative photoresist is not recommended. And as you know, nowadays these photolithography process is used for making submicron devices, and again resolution should be very high. So obvious choice is positive photoresist, not negative photoresist, because negative photoresist has got lot of limitation because of the basic two problems. One is the swelling action, another is size of the molecules in chain reaction. Aspect ratio is small in case of negative photoresist. And it has advantage of large throughput. What is throughput? Throughput is the number of wafers you can process in a particular amount of time, say 1 hour. How many wafers you can process in negative photoresist process? That is called throughput. In case of negative photoresist, throughput is large, and that will also be explained in the next one view graph, why the throughput of negative photoresist is large compared to the positive photoresist. And since throughput is large, it is a low cost, because in a fixed amount of time, if you can process more number of wafers, then obviously the lithography process cost is less. And this particular negative photoresist process is rugged also. Why? Because you see, little bit underdeveloped or overdeveloped development doesn't create any problem. In case of positive photoresist, little bit overdevelopment will create problem. Because I told you, even unexposed resin also will be dissolved little bit, which is not true in case of negative photoresist. Okay. In this curve, we have compared the thickness of the photoresist film in case of positive and negative for different spin speed. The bluish curve is for negative photoresist and the yellow curve is for positive photoresist. And one thing you may note that if the spin speed increases, the photoresist thickness reduces. Photoresist thickness reduces because of the higher spin speed for a particular value of the viscosity of that particular resist. And in case of negative photoresist, for the same spin speed, we found the thickness is less. What is the reason? Viscosity is less. If viscosity is less, then it is much more fluid. Fluidity is more. If viscosity is high, it's thicker, isn't it? So if viscosity is less, then in a particular spin speed, the thickness will be less compared to higher viscosity photoresist. So you can see here, for getting 1 micron in case of positive resist, we require about 4000 rpm, and roughly the same value of thickness we get in case of negative resist, nearly 2 to 2500 rpm. So this tells us that the viscosity of the negative photoresist is less compared to the positive little bit thicker. And if you have this curve with you, you can adjust the spin speed to have different thickness of photoresist, either whether it is positive or negative. You can adjust the spin speed, isn't it? Now, positive photoresist, let us see what are its advantages and disadvantages. Higher resolution capability has been observed in case of positive photoresist. Aspect ratio is well above unity here, which was less in case of negative photoresist. Positive photoresist does not swell during development. That is a good advantage. Because of this particular property, its resolution is very high. You can get higher resolution, even less than 1 micron. In case of negative, it was within 2 to 3 micron. Less than 2 micron was difficult. And lower throughput, that is its disadvantage point. Why throughput is low in case of positive and high in case of negative, you can understand that in the next view graph. And since throughput is low, obviously cost will be high. This is the response curve. This curve will tell you why the throughput is low in case of positive photoresist and it is high in case of negative photoresist. So this curve shows the percent resist remains versus log of exposure energy. Log of exposure energy means ultraviolet energy you are exposing, that exposure energy versus the percent resist remains after development, that is plotted. Okay. Now you see here, in case of negative photoresist, on exposure, it becomes less soluble. I hope you remember that. In case of negative photoresist, on exposure, it becomes less soluble. That means as if photoresist becomes harder. So that means when exposure is not there, it is completely soluble up to this. If you increase the exposure energy, and if it attains a value, say ET, which is threshold energy, then it percent resist remains more. That means it's not soluble. After development, it is not soluble, it doesn't wash away. So then the thickness of the photoresist remains. That means percent resist remains, it becomes hardened, so it remains, it is not washing away. And just after ET value, if we apply about 2 times of ET threshold value, 2 to 3 times to ET value, then we found it is a flat nature here. That means it is almost 100% remaining. The percent resist remains is here, somewhere here is 100%. 100% remaining will be there. Now, if you look into the positive photoresist response curve, then initially it will remain full because positive photoresist on exposure it becomes softened, in developed solution it removes, washes out. It will be soluble only on exposure of energy. So now initially it is not soluble, positive pair, so it remains after development. Then if you increase the exposure and energy, then we found it started soluble in developer solution, that means remaining photoresist is less. Then at ET energy, if the whole resist film is exposed to ET energy, then what we found, it is completely soluble, because as we explained earlier that on exposure the positive photoresist will become soluble in developer solution. So here is complete soluble. Now from the response curve you can see here this particular point, the threshold value, threshold energy of negative photoresist is less compared to the threshold energy of positive photoresist. So for complete reaction you have to use higher energy in case of positive photoresist. Higher energy means in exposure unit you have to expose for a longer time, because exposure intensity of the UV source normally remains same, constant. So if it is same, to have more energy you have to expose it for a longer time. That means your throughput will be less. Per 1 hour, number of wafers exposed and developed will be less. That is cost will be little bit higher. But in case of negative photoresist, we found here, since threshold energy is low here, it needs very less time, less exposure time. That means its throughput will be high. In 1 hour or in a particular time, the number of wafers exposed in negative photoresist process is more than that of positive photoresist process. So then throughput will be high and automatically cost will be less. So this is one comparison regarding the threshold energy of the positive and negative photoresist. So in summarize, we can say at low exposure energy, negative resist completely soluble in developer solution here. As exposure is increased above a threshold energy ET, here is the value, more of the resist film remains after development. At exposure energy of 2 to 3 times ET, you see 2 to 3 times ET here, every very little of the resist film is dissolved, because 2 to 3 times of ET, the resist film is not dissolved, it remains almost 100%. That is in case of negative photoresist. And what we can summarize in case of positive photoresist? For positive photoresist, the resist solubility in its developer is finite even at zero exposure energy. The solubility gradually increases until at some threshold energy, it becomes completely soluble. Thus, positive resist requires more exposure energy than negative resist. The response curve shows that. And I think you are doing some experiment on photolithography. Using different spin speed, you are measuring the thickness of the photoresist. At the same time, also another part of your photolithography experiment is that you change the exposure time for a fixed thickness photoresist film, and after development you see measure the photoresist thickness, how much photoresist thickness remains after development for exposure at different times. Easily you can do these two experiments to verify the response curve as well as the earlier curve, which shows the spin speed versus photoresist thickness. You can easily verify in your laboratory, and I hope this is one experiment. In one experiment, you will do that. Exposure energy is defined by exposure intensity, which is milliwatt per centimeter square, into exposure time, and that is in second. So that is the exposure energy, and its unit is millijoule per centimeter square. And the exposure unit, the ultraviolet light, we use normally 300 to 400 nanometer wavelength range. 300 to 400 nanometer wavelength range. If you go below that means below 200 nanometer, means 2000 angstrom unit, then it enters into deep ultraviolet. So that is deep UV lithography. Ultraviolet is below violet wavelength. Violet wavelength is 4000 angstrom unit. So that is 4000 or 4500 nearly that. So if you use the wavelength of light below that is ultraviolet. And normally we use 300 to 400, that means 3000 to 4000 nanometer wavelength for exposure of the ultraviolet light. And again, this intensity, you see, exposure energy depends on the exposure intensity. That intensity depends on how far is the lamp from the substrate. If the lamp is very close to the substrate, intensity will be higher. And another thing is also how much the supply you are using, how much current is flowing to the lamp, because lamp will glow with certain supply voltage, and that supply voltage and current you fix, and then you measure the intensity of the film with the intensity measurement equipment. And that intensity, time to time in the same mask aligner, you have to observe, so that whether the intensity is varying or deteriorating or not, you have to check. If the intensity changes with time, then what will happen? All your exposure time, development time, etc., will be again re-standardized, isn't it? Then otherwise you will not get the faithful replication of the mask onto the wafer. So this intensity means the lamp input power and the distance of the lamp from the substrate. And distance of the lamp from the substrate is normally kept fixed by the machine manufacturer. That you cannot change a lot. The lamp housing and the mask plate is kept, a certain gap is maintained, and that changing that gap is very difficult. One way you can change the input power of the lamp, and that normally we don't do. So in that case, the exposure intensity, we keep it fixed, only we change exposure time to change the exposure energy. Okay. So this is all about the positive and negative photoresist behavior, its action. I will stop today here at this point. So next lecture I will discuss on the optical lithography technique. Different techniques means machines, the mask aligner machines, what are the different techniques used for photolithography process. Thank you.
Oh.